India's Prime Minister tours Africa, raising his country's profile. What sort of economic and political clout is New Delhi seeking? Can it succeed in a continent dominated by Western and Chinese influence? This is Inside Story. Hello and welcome to the show. I'm Sami Zeidan. Indian Prime Minister Narendra Modi's African tour was intended to attract trade and investment. He's offered billions of dollars in credit and development financing to build what he calls a partnership for prosperity. But India is also playing catch up to China, which is Africa's largest trading partner. Modi says his focus is on human development through trade rather than the extraction of resources. Here's some of what he said in South Africa before he left for Tanzania and Kenya.
India's growth story is one of the brightest spots, but India's economic advance is not for the benefit of our society alone. It would be my effort that outcomes of our development partnership reaches those sections of our society who need it the most, especially our youth. Come, let us partner with each other and take advantage of the great opportunities that occupy our bright future.
In 2014, China's trade with Africa stood at $200 billion. Electronics and textiles flowed into African nations, while African natural resources went to China. Well, that same year, trade levels between the US and Africa, for example, were half that figure at $100 billion. Meanwhile, Indian trade with Africa stood at only $70 billion. Last year's India-Africa Forum, hosted by the Indian government, brought all 54 African countries together for the first time. China's economic slowdown is forcing some African nations to look to India as an alternative. Its economy, expected to grow at 7.5%, and offers a large consumer market. Well, Prime Minister Modi's tour has taken him to Mozambique, South Africa and Tanzania. They and many other African nations are increasingly looking to India for investment to help their local industry and create jobs. Charles Stratford spoke to business leaders in Kenya's capital, Nairobi, the final stop on Modi's tour.
This pharmaceutical company in Nairobi manufactures 250 medicines. It supplies the Kenyan government, local private companies and exports to countries all over Africa. It employs around 500 people. The raw product is imported from India. Pharmaceuticals, steel, machine tools and vehicles are among India's main exports to Kenya.
In Africa, we really need to develop the pharmaceutical industry. We cannot just go and have imported materials coming in all the time as finished goods. We need to develop our industry. We need to create employment for our people. We need to be self-sufficient, just like India was and is right now.
This is the largest of around 40 companies in Kenya that use Indian raw materials to manufacture medicines. Now, it's hoped that Prime Minister Modi's visit here is going to help generate more interest in investment and bilateral trade between India and Kenya. Annual bilateral trade at the moment stands at around $2.5 billion, but around 95% of that is made up of Indian exports here, and that's huge as a trade imbalance. India has strong cultural and historical ties with Kenya due to their shared British colonial past. Around 130,000 Kenyans are of Indian descent, and they are an important link between the business communities of the two countries. Vimal Shah's company manufactures food and hygiene products. He employs 6,000 people. The company has factories across East Africa and exports to countries across the continent.
The point is that there's a lot more happening in India, especially in the ICT sector, in terms of outsourcing, in terms of a lot of the soft issues where we can become the Silicon Savannah here, and we can actually use a lot of IT systems.
India wants to expand into new regions, especially former French and Portuguese colonies like Senegal and Mozambique. India's trade with Africa was worth around $70 billion in 2014. In contrast, China's trade with Africa is worth around three times that amount. But African countries are looking for an alternative to the Chinese business model, which tends to involve Chinese state enterprise and low-interest loans in return for favorable access to mineral and oil projects.
India's 1.3 billion people needs food, and those are the materials that we export to India. We need to exploit our land more and feed India.
The combined population of Africa and India amounts to more than a quarter of the world's population. Better business ties could improve hundreds of millions of lives. Charles Stratford, Al Jazeera, Nairobi.
Let's bring in our guest into the show now. We have in Nairobi joining us via Skype, Alex Awiti, director of the East African Institute at the Aga Khan University. In New Delhi, Manancha Chakrabarty, an associate fellow at the Observer Research Foundation. And in Hong Kong, we have China analyst Andrew Leung. Welcome to you all. They say ladies first, so let's start with Manancha then. What do you think ultimately India is seeking from Africa?
There are a number of things that come into play. For instance, the first point that I would try to make is that India and Africa have traditionally shared very good relations. We were part of the anti-colonial movements, so that kind of goodwill is there. But what has improved in the last 10 years is economic ties between India and Africa. So India's economics is going to play a very important role in furthering India's interests in Africa. Within the broad realm of economics, as I may put it, I think the sectors which are of main interest are the energy sector, the agriculture sector, pharmaceutical sector.
All right, interesting. Andrew Leung, Africa, an important destination or source for the Indian economy. The same could be said for the Chinese economy. Do you see a bit of rivalry breeding there between New Delhi and Beijing?
Well, naturally, there's, if not covert, but at least a kind of hidden rivalry, not only for India and China in Africa, but in other theaters as well, for example, in the Indian Ocean and the South China Sea and so on. The rivalry is in terms of international influence and power projection, both as rising global powers. But on the other hand, as far as trade and investments are concerned, India's future economic trajectory has to depend on creation of jobs and also industrialization. Now, for industrialization, India has to import energy from outside India. In fact, by the year 2040, India's dependence on foreign import of energy will be as much as 90%. And of course, Africa is a very important source. Now, as far as compared with China, China, of course, has been exploiting India's resources. But China's development model is not just infrastructure for resources. It's not just trading resources, but it's also building necessary infrastructure, roads, highways, utilities, as well as schools and hospitals. And this infrastructure development is essential to India's, to Africa's economic trajectory. But on the other hand, besides rivalry, there's also a hidden agenda as far as the Modi's visit is concerned. And of course, is seeking a future position, membership, a permanent member of the National Security Council, and for which African countries support.
Okay, well, hang on, Andrew. We'll come in more detail later to the question of perhaps some of the political role. But you mentioned a lot of really interesting points there about the different approaches of China and India towards Africa. I want in a moment to pick up on that theme, but before we do, I want to turn to Alex first and ask the question, Alex. At the end of the day, I mean, having people competing for your attention, that sounds like a good thing. Is that only good news for Africa and Africans?
Well, I think to a very large extent, Africa is in is somewhat an enviable position, but I think it's also fraught with a lot of risks, and I think it's a pretty tricky time for Africa, especially given the extent to which it can navigate this very complex kind of self-vested interest state of play. And I like to think about the renewed attention to Africa as maybe the 21st century scramble for Africa. You know, we just had Benjamin Netanyahu visit Kenya, Ethiopia, Rwanda, and Uganda, and we had the Turkish president visiting here. The Chinese president and prime minister have been kind of all over across Africa. But I think what is interesting is going to be the models of partnership that these two Asian giants are going to structure across Africa. Of course, China is now widely perceived as being much more extractive, and its development footprint is driven basically by state corporations in huge infrastructure deals and cheap loans. I think what India is suggesting is a kind of a more trade-driven relationship. But I think India has many advantages culturally and from a historical perspective, given the kind of common political heritage with a lot of African countries, especially Kenya, Tanzania, and maybe.
Alex, do you think that means that India can catch up with China? I mean, $200 billion, that's a big number to catch up on, isn't it?
I think India has a potential. I think it's not really, I wouldn't want to think about it as the volume of direct foreign investment flows, but I think it's the quality of that investment. And I think one thing that makes India a little bit different is the fact that it has a huge diaspora in Africa. There are a resident population, citizens. If you look at the structure of commerce and industry and banking and financial sector, a lot of the dominant economic and financial players in Kenya, Uganda, Tanzania, Mozambique are actually of Indian descent. So if they get the backing and the blessing of their governments, they can really change the quality of the relationship between Africa and India.
Interesting. Malancha, just how similar is India's economic approach to Africa when you compare it with China?
That's a very interesting question, you know, because in the past few months or even the last couple of years, there is a lot of talk about India and China and the competition for African resources. But what is interesting is that, you know, just a few years ago, the Western media was sort of trying to project that, you know, India and China are together in this new scramble for African resources. But I would urge everybody to go for a more sophisticated analysis of the engagement of both India and China in Africa. For instance, when we talk about energy, it is not only something like oil that India imports from Africa. India exports a lot of refined petroleum oil to African countries. So it is not just that India is going in to just extract the oil, it is also exporting refined oil, which is of interest for African countries. Secondly, we tend sometimes to not give adequate attention to renewable energy, which is a critical sector. Now, renewable energy is a sector which India is particularly interested in, and last year the Prime Minister announced the solar initiative, and both Africa and India have a lot to gain, because India and Africa have huge development concerns. We still have a lot of villages which are not electrified. So people, off-grid electricity, solar lanterns are both important for India and
but
Africa.
But hang on, Malancha, what do you make of those who argue that there is one basic commonality? While China has been criticized, perhaps by countries which are envious of it, perhaps for good reasons, but China's been criticized as focusing simply on an approach of taking resources out of Africa. Isn't India up to the same thing? 84% of India's imports from Africa in 2014 were raw materials, according to Brookings.
Which is true. I mean, it is not wrong. It is absolutely true that, you know, if you look at the trade composition for both India and China, Africa is largely a raw material exporter, and one cannot contest that. And one will not be able to, negate the facts, but where the difference lies is in how things are moving. For instance, although overall we've criticized China for extracting resources, there are instances where refined, for instance, I can give the example of Democratic Republic of Congo, where there was a shift from export of raw copper to refined copper. So a lot is more complicated than just looking at aggregate figures. I would suggest that, you know, we look at country level data, then things are slightly more different. Even in case of India, India of course needs energy, it needs oil, and it is importing a lot of oil. But
all right, let me turn back on that point to Alex for a moment before we go back to Andrew. How much of India's investment or China's investment is actually going towards developing production, industrial capacity, you know, something that moves Africa up the value chain?
Well, I guess to a very large extent, if I may speak for maybe Tanzania and Kenya, India, you know, China has been invested hugely in developing and modernizing the railway system, moving these things from up to standard gauge railway. I think that, from an economic connectivity perspective, has huge opportunities to help kind of integrate the both national and regional economies much better. China is making huge investments in the education sector through direct and direct support to universities. We have a huge number of centers of Confucius centers across Kenyan universities, and there's an increasing number of Kenyan students who are going up to China. So I think, as Malancha said, it's certainly more complex than the movement of raw materials. But I think, having said that, I think, you know, the fact that there's a huge trade imbalance right now in the favor of both India and China is really not the problem of those two countries. I think it's really, can Africa invest rapidly to ramp up its capacity for more equitable partnership, to be an equal player in this complex globalized arena? So I think a lot of that is going to be, can Africa be very strategic in the types of partnerships and deals that it strikes that helps it to build its capacity?
That's a good point. Let's take that to Andrew. What do you make of that argument that perhaps the level of governance in Africa is not at that stage where they can actually strike good deals that are really in the national interest? And based on that, the quality of benefit to Africa is not as much as it is to perhaps China or India when one looks at the trade and investment relationship.
Well, in fact, the shape of Africa is changing in that in the next couple of decades, we are going to see more and more of this kind of African middle class coming into the picture. By the year 2025, for example, nearly two-thirds of Africa's population will be middle class, and then their aspirations are much higher, and they seek more well-paid jobs rather than jobs in agriculture. So I think for that, they need a great deal of infrastructure building, a great deal of capacity building in terms, as I said, of more factories, more skills, training, as well as schools and hospitals and access to education, for example. I think this is the agenda of Africa's future development, focusing more people-centered kind of development. Now, for that, China engagement of Africa has been very, very strong in terms of building schools, hospitals, highways, and so on and so forth as a package. In fact, you can say that China's engagement with Africa is infrastructure for resources. Now, on the other scale, a very distinctive China's model is the creation of special economic zones throughout Africa. I mean, this these are very large economic zones managed by Chinese companies, but also creating a lot of local jobs. So I think that that's a very, very big difference. Plus the fact, of course, China, through the engagement of Africa, brings Africa's at a kind of export into the world. Markets, okay. As China is at the hub of the world production and value chain.
All right, let's shift gears a little bit and talk about perhaps the political goals. Yes, I was just coming to you, Malancha. You know, earlier on, Andrew mentioned perhaps some of India's political goals in Africa, a permanent seat at the UN Security Council, backing, African backing for membership at the Nuclear Suppliers Group. There surely is quite a list of perhaps political goals for Narendra Modi when he's touring Africa too, and not just economics, right, Malancha?
Yes, absolutely. There are a number of political goals, and you've mentioned about Nuclear Suppliers Group and also the permanent seat which India has been vying for a long time. So African vote becomes very important. But also we must remember that we've partnered with Africa in WTO for a long time. We have a history of partnership on economic issues, particularly on agriculture issues in WTO. So these are some of the issues that are very important and critical for India. But I would like to add a little bit to what Andrew said. Okay. I do not completely agree with his argument on job creation when it comes to China, because I have come across a lot of literature and a lot of protests, Chinese investments, as well as even Chinese development finance has come in for a lot of criticism, because they are typically large investments. They just come, build the school, hospital, or the bridge or the project, and they are made largely by Chinese labor, which has been a bone of contention. Right. On the other hand, India has a better track record when it comes to creating local jobs, and India also helps in upgrading African capacity. So I think that's one of the reasons, okay, why India scores over China, although China has a much larger, operates at a much larger scale.
I'm talking of Andrew, I want to come back briefly to you. Do you think China is going to continue to resist the sort of political moves which India is trying to make to get backing for membership of the NSG, the UN Security Council, and so on and so forth?
As far as the National Security Council permanent seats are concerned, I think there is also a movement amongst the developing countries, India particularly, but also Africa. Some of the African nations are beginning to question, why is Africa not represented on this, in the Security Council? Now, as far as China is concerned, if only India is admitted, then of course India is has allied with the United States, has got more relationship with the United States, a stronger alliance with the United States compared with China. But if Africa is brought into the Security Council at the same time, this would act as a balance in China's favor. So I think that China, right, is not totally, would not be totally against the idea of expanding, okay, the membership of the national of the permanent seats, provided that both Africa and India are brought in at the same time.
All right, we've got about a minute left, so I want to give it to Alex, because I could see you were angling to get in a moment ago. Go ahead, Alex.
So I just wanted to speak to a point that was raised by Andrew regarding kind of Africa's kind of future going forward. By 2025, we'll have two-thirds of Africa might actually consume at the level of the middle class. But I think there's a very interesting point here. While right now the African economy is largely driven either by agriculture and export of raw materials, there is a trend of a service component that is becoming a critical driver of the economy. And a lot of us might think that Africa might actually skip the industrialization phase. And that's where kind of the mass creation of jobs might actually lie. So what I'm thinking about is, how can Africa begin a conversation with India and China that enables it to ramp up its industrial capacity, build the human capital that can help move Africa into an industrial phase? What we're seeing that drives largely the service sector is the cheap imports that come from India and China that are basically creating massive amounts of retail that is characterizing a lot of the new urban Africans, most of the telecom and all of these other kind of financial services. But these tend to create very, right, few jobs, and it helps to really exacerbate the unequal distribution in terms of the economic growth that Africa has experienced in what is now characterized as Africa rising. Right. So I think Africa, the question is, does Africa have the sophistication in terms of diplomatic capability to push for a more enlightened relationship building, especially between China and India?
That's a question, of course, time will answer. Thanks now to our guests. Unfortunately, don't give time, we are out of time. Let's thank our guests, Alex Awiti, Malancha Chakrabarty, and Andrew Leung. And thank you too for watching. You can see the program again anytime by visiting our website, aljazeera.com. For further discussion, you can also head over to our Facebook page. That's facebook.com/AJInsideStory. You can also join the conversation on Twitter. Our handle there, @AJInsideStory. From me, Sami Zeidan, and the whole team here. For now, it's goodbye.